I got this criminal thing wrong.
Locked up in Leavenworth.
I've got to deal with the craziness. I've got to deal with the bars closing.
A small-time crook tries to make his escape.
I was really tired of it.
The only way he knows how.
Make it into a makeshift noose and prepare for my last night on Earth.
Welcome to the 700 Club. You know, it's an inconvenient truth that we are burning so much fossil fuel and so much CO2 in the air that it is causing our atmosphere to get hotter and hotter and hotter and hotter. So we've got to cut out all that stuff.
That's true. Well, you know, there's so many different theories as to what is causing the Earth to change and the climate and this and that. But now, an important new scientific study actually suggests that the leading cause of the climate change may actually just be the sun, not human beings. Well, Dale Hurd has that story.
In the world of climate science, the news came as a bit of a bombshell. A new study from CERN, the prestigious European Organization of Nuclear Research, supports the theory that periods of Earth warming are caused by solar activity and so-called cosmic rays, rather than by human activity. More than 2 years ago, CBN News was among the first news organizations to explain what is known as the Svensmark cosmic ray theory, developed at the Danish Space Institute.
Yes, we have done experiments, and the experiments seem to support this idea that cosmic rays somehow are involved in the climate on Earth.
The Earth is constantly being bombarded with cosmic rays, high-energy particles emitted from exploding stars. The Svensmark cosmic ray theory says that when these cosmic rays enter the Earth's atmosphere, they help create clouds. An active sun strengthens a magnetic shield around the Earth that lets fewer cosmic rays get through. But if the sun is less active, as it has been recently, more cosmic rays get through. And the more cosmic rays, the more clouds, and the cooler global temperatures will be. This chamber demonstrates the effect of cosmic rays in cloud formation. The agents, called aerosols that create clouds, look like cobwebs or strands of hair. The important new study by CERN, which operates the multi-million-dollar Large Hadron Collider, created a bit of a public relations problem for the European Union, which is so committed to the theory of man-made climate change, it has a whole directorate working on the theory. These days, attacking the idea of man-made global warming can be risky politically. Former Vice President and global warming spokesman Al Gore has compared climate change skeptics to racists who should be shunned by society. But that's mild compared with what others have said, that global warming skeptics are like Holocaust deniers and child molesters. Dale Hurd, CBN News.
Well, there is no doubt that the CO2 levels in our world are higher than they've been in millennia, so there's no doubt that when you see it, it goes straight up. So we are creating a whole lot of that. We're burning a lot of fossil fuel. You go to a country like China, and it's choking so bad you can hardly breathe in the downtown cities. Mm-hmm. But, have you heard about the Maya calendar?
I have heard about it, but not enough to, like, describe it. So don't say, Christy, describe it, because I can't.
I just want to know if you've heard about it.
I've heard of it.
Well, the Mayans, everybody's talking about it. They think that there's going to be a big shift in the year 2012. They think, as a matter of fact, December of 2012. And what they say, and I don't know how those Mayans figured it out, but we're in the middle of the Milky Way galaxy.
Uh-huh.
Okay. And the Milky Way looks like a great big cloud, but it's all these stars. And our solar system is only one star in the Milky Way.
Mm-hmm.
Well, they think that at the core of the Milky Way, that there's going to be an alignment of stars and alignment of our planets, and it's going to exert a tremendous gravitational pull on the Earth. Mm-hmm. Now, whether they know what they're talking about, I have no idea, but they figured it out, and some astronomers are saying, it looks like those Indians were right.
Mm-hmm.
How they got it, we don't know. But what we're looking for that could be devastating is some kind of a pulse coming from outer space that could hit this Earth. And, you know, the electromagnetic pulse that would take away our control systems of our electronics, that is a very real threat from a world, a war situation, this pull of the solar system could be very significant. So if our sun's getting out of control, mm-hmm. got sunspot activities, and this pulse comes to us, it could be a bad thing. So are the Mayans right? Is CERN right? Who's right? Is Al Gore right? Well, he's come up with something that many scientists go along with, but it's hot on Mars, and they don't have any SUVs running around in Mars. They're not burning any coal plants, but mm-hmm. Mars is getting hotter. Mm-hmm. Why? Because the sun's getting hotter, or whatever that activity is. So keep an open mind, ladies and gentlemen, as we go down the road. Let's not just get stampeded by the latest theory. Mm-hmm. Well, Lee Webb has the rest of our top stories from the CBN Newsroom. Lee?
Pat, Americans want President Obama's health care law repealed. Rasmussen Report conducted a poll, and the numbers run counter to predictions that the law would be widely accepted. 57% of likely voters support repeal. Only 37% oppose getting rid of it. Just 34% of voters think the health care law will be good for the country. 56% think health care costs will go up. Only 15% believe they will go down. 55% also believe the law will increase the federal deficit. As much as $60 billion in U.S. taxpayer funds have gone to waste in Iraq and Afghanistan over the past decade, and that number could grow. The Commission on Wartime Contracting reports poor planning, corruption, and fraud have contributed to the wasteful spending. In a report to Congress, the Commission cites numerous examples of waste, like an Afghani agricultural program that cost the USA millions of dollars a day. The commission's report says the government needs to overhaul spending in war zones. Pat?
Well, you know, there's no control apparently over the spending. It seems to be, but it's mostly after the fact. And they say, well, in order to win the war, you've got to put the troops out there, put the material out there, and it's let's go full speed ahead. Well, $60 billion is a lot of money. If I had my way, I think I would pull out of Afghanistan. I think we don't need Afghanistan. I think the government of Afghanistan is hopelessly corrupt. Karzai is corrupt, although we have soldiers, Marines, airmen who are doing a splendid job fighting in that area. We really don't need it. We cannot be the policemen of the entire world, and it's costing us a bundle. And so, well, it's not cutting and running to get out of that thing. So what we need to do is to declare victory and leave. And I know that probably some people disagree, say, well, you're being isolationist. Well, maybe so, but I just don't think we can afford it. And the waste and the fraud has been appalling. Lee?
Pat, the acting head of the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms has been removed. Kenneth Melson was reassigned to a new position in the wake of a scandal involving gun trafficking in Mexico. Republicans criticized the ATF for the operation, which was called Fast and Furious. The ATF put 2,000 guns in the hands of criminals. The goal was to arrest the traffickers as they brought the illegal weapons across the Mexican border. But the plan backfired when it lost track of most of the guns. Some of the weapons were linked to violent crimes here in the U.S. At least two of those guns were found where Mexican bandits killed a U.S. Border Patrol agent. About 2.5 million people are still without power after Hurricane Irene. At least 44 people are dead across 13 states following the storm, and officials in Vermont are now airlifting food and water to desperate residents cut off by floodwaters. Charlene Israel has that story.
Irene is long gone, but the floodwaters are still taking a toll on the Northeast. Damaged railroad lines, washed out highways, and whole communities isolated.
What I saw was, the first thing was when I looked out the window, I saw the house wasn't in the right place.
Dangerously damaged infrastructure, 2.5 million people without power, and thousands of waterlogged homes and businesses continue to affect the lives of residents from North Carolina through New England. In Vermont, rescue crews are still trying to reach residents in 11 towns left isolated and desperate.
The water was really, really up very high, and the force of it was beyond our comprehension.
But for some, this isn't their first flood.
This is my second flood in 5 years. my whole apartment. I can't go back in for like a month, 2 months until we gut all the walls, do all the electrical work again.
In Conway, New Hampshire, 22 were rescued in just a few hours.
The worst possible conditions of swift water rescue. There's a guy in a tree, hanging in a tree. We had another person in rising water in a house that ended up in his attic.
Irene's floodwaters damaged 80 homes in Conway alone. In Vermont, the National Guard was delivering food and supplies to the stranded. Charlene Israel, CBN News.
And here in Virginia, Irene knocked out power to more than 1.2 million people. Virginia Dominion Power has restored electricity to about two-thirds of them. It is the second largest restoration effort in Dominion Power's history, behind Hurricane Isabel back in 2003. Irene also left some North Carolina residents locked out of their homes longer than expected. Residents of Hatteras Island tried to return to the Outer Banks yesterday, but they were turned away by police. Only emergency workers were allowed in.
I expected to go back in 2-3 days.
And that is not
I just case. Brought one pair of shoes, just a few sets of clothes and pajamas.
Just going to have a lot of damage down there and just want to know how long it's going to be before we can get back to work.
Operation Blessing is visiting Hatteras today to find out what kind of help stranded residents might need down there. Pat?
You know, we were here, we're used to some pretty heavy storms. We're right here on the coast, and to us, this Irene was a nothing storm. It was just some heavy wind and some heavy rain, and we kind of went through, and that was the end of it. But I'm astounded. I understand this is one of the 10 most costly natural disasters in American history. You know, it just it didn't comprehend it
well. Well, you know, this is what I was thinking about, that very fact, is I think, one, the storm was so widespread, but I think part of it, too, is here in Virginia Beach, we are so used to it, Pat, that maybe the level of preparation we had that maybe other states didn't have. And so,
well,
you know.
You have a special story. You were expecting a family gathering, and you were going to go all the way down to the Outer Banks, to Duck, or one of those places.
You were going to go to Cape Hatteras.
Cape Hatteras, and you had a house rented, and it was going to be beautiful and a lot of room for all your family. So what happened?
Well, they called and said, North Carolina's not going to work, but you know what, Christy? Your house in Virginia Beach will.
They all descended on your little house?
Not all, just a good handful of them, but it's a good handful.
Do they love each other still?
Listen, we're all digging each other, getting along. You know it's Jesus, brother, if the family can be in a house that long.
It has to be.
Well, the kids are playing Wii, and the family, we just keep going out to eat.
Okay. Well,
but it's fun. It's actually been a treasure.
A special family vacation. Okay. All right. What's next?
Well, still ahead on the 700 Club, we're going to take your questions for Pat from our chat room. So all we're asking you to do is log on to CBN.com because we're going to bring it online later on. But first, a story about a horrific crisis in Sudan.
There are 70,000 to 90,000 people that are probably going to die in the next month to 2 months because the roads are shut down to the north and the flights are not coming in.
But see how that didn't stop a team from Operation Blessing when we come back.
Coming up later, locked up in Leavenworth.
I've got to deal with the craziness. I've got to deal with the bars closing.
A small-time crook tries to make his escape.
I was really tired of it.
The only way he knows how.
Make it into a makeshift noose and prepare for my last night on Earth.
Saw you on TV. Gotta say, it was painful to watch.
Try living it.
Spend 7 days in Utopia.
Wow.
You'll find your game.
First, you have to see it. Feel it. Trust it.
Reminds me of someone else I used to know.
That he does.
I think some time here might do you good.
Sure is beautiful.
I don't think that your coming here was an accident.
7 days in Utopia. Rated G.
Hi, I'm Howard Dvorkin, the founder of Consolidated Credit. For almost two decades, Consolidated Credit has helped millions of Americans just like you.
We can consolidate and reduce your monthly payments by up to 50%, save you thousands in interest and fees, and help you get out of debt fast.
We've helped over 5 million people. Let us help you.
Call Consolidated Credit now. 1-800-441-1202. 1-800-441-1202.
Tomorrow,
I thought this was the true religion of God.
She went searching for answers.
And I was very interested.
And found a chat room.
I said, really? Tell me about it.
Why she embraced Islam.
They really convinced me that this was the religion of God and everything that I had been taught as a child was not the truth.
And why she renounced her faith.
All I could do was cry, and I cried for days.
Tomorrow on the 700 Club.
Well, it was a big celebration when South Sudan, which was primarily Christian, some part animist, broke away and formed a separate country free from the domination of the very extreme Islamic Republic of Sudan in the north. Well, the Islamic regime isn't stopping. They're launching a brutal assault now against Christians in an area known as the Nuba Mountains. That includes airstrikes. They've got these Antonov airplanes, and they come in there and they attack churches and houses and even schools. Brutal, absolutely brutal by the so-called peaceful followers of Islam. Gary Lane has the story of this growing tragedy and what Operation Blessing is doing to help those beleaguered people in the Nuba Mountains.
It's a new humanitarian crisis. Ethnic cleansing of the Nuba people has left thousands dead, and many others fighting for their lives. The Nuba Mountains are home to one of Sudan's largest Christian communities. They're being tormented by daily airstrikes and house-to-house raids from President Omar Bashir's armed forces. Bashir is an indicted war criminal for the genocide in Darfur. Virginia Congressman Frank Wolf says it's important the church in the West stands up for these persecuted Christians.
I think the church in the West has to really do a better job of advocating for the persecuted church. Well, if anything, hopefully this hearing can motivate not only the administration, but also the church, the leaders of all the denominations to come together for advocate for this.
Bashir's soldiers are reportedly burning down churches. Bishop Andudu is from Sudan's South Kordofan. He also testified to the devastation that happened at his diocese.
My house was shot with the guns, and my chaplain was able to escape through the window. And also my offices and cyber cafe was burned down, and cathedral as well.
Brad Phillips is with the Persecution Project Foundation. He's just returned from the Nuba Mountains. He testified before U.S. congressional leaders that aid access to the region is limited.
There's a serious humanitarian crisis that is approaching. There are 70 to 90,000 people that are probably going to die in the next month to 2 months because the roads are shut down to the north and the flights are not coming in.
But that didn't stop a team from CBN's Operation Blessing. When he heard about extreme shortages of medicine in the Nubas, President Bill Horan put together an emergency relief mission.
It was dangerous, but it was life-saving.
We found a pilot willing to fly us into the Nuba Mountains, and we took off and flew most of the way under the cover of the clouds to avoid being spotted by the northern warplanes. We landed on this tiny dirt strip, and then the scramble was on to unload the plane as fast as we could because we were told that literally any minute the Antonov bombers could show up and start bombing the airstrip.
Soldiers from the SPLA, the Sudan People's Liberation Army, drove the team several hours to the hideout of Lieutenant General Abdel Aziz. Aziz directs the liberation movement in the Nuba Mountains.
The National Congress Party of Khartoum have declared jihad, Islamic jihad, on all the Nuba, whether you are Muslim, whether you are Christian. Nuba did not go and attack Khartoum. Nuba did not go and take anything from Khartoum. Instead, Khartoum is the one exploiting the area. They are taking the oil. This is the only oil producing state in the north, in the remaining part of the country.
The people of the Nuba Mountains enjoyed a six-year period of relative peace after the signing of the North-South Peace Agreement in 2005. That ended last June when the northern government attacked the Nuba capital city of Kadugli. Operation Blessing's Bill Horan was shown some of the destruction.
A school was actually targeted, a school that was filled with children in school, in session. Two huge bombs, thank God they missed, but not by much. Two giant craters in the soil, but it was close enough to the school that some shrapnel fell and penetrated the walls of some of the school buildings. One child was killed and a whole group of children were injured. Who in the world would target on purpose, children.
What relief was delivered by Operation Blessing? An emergency health kit containing enough medicine and medical supplies to establish a much-needed health clinic that will serve 10,000 Nubian people for 90 days.
We purchased two of those complete emergency kits in the Netherlands and flew them in. Those medicines are now, at this moment, being used to treat the sick, the injured, the wounded in the clinics in the Nuba Mountains. The people of the Nuba Mountains, no one can hear their voice. They're suffering in silence. We need to be their voice. The United States and all the nations of the free world, the United Nations, they have to quit ignoring this, and then they have to quit talking about it. They have to take decisive action. There needs to be action by the United Nations. If the United Nations stands for people, please defend the people of Nuba.
Gary Lane, CBN News.
Wow.
Ladies and gentlemen, you can talk all you want to about Islam being a religion of peace. That is just not a fact. Look at what they're doing, what they did in Darfur. It was black on black. I mean, it wasn't a question of, trying to look after a different race. This was black on black, and some of the people in the area of Darfur were actually Muslims. Didn't matter. But these people in the north, they're Arab, and they wanted to kill off these black people living in Darfur. Well, it's the same thing in the Nuba Mountains. It is just hideous. And the leader of Sudan, the northern part, has been declared a war criminal by the international court, and yet he's still moving about freely. Something's got to be done to restrain him, because this is genocide. It's one more example of genocide. It is just horrible to think what's happening, and it's being done one more time in the name of Islam. Not a good testimony. Christy?
Praise God, people like you and Operation Blessing are there. Well, coming up, he was sentenced to 24 years in the slammer. So this con actually came up with an escape plan.
I actually prepared for my last night on Earth. While I was preparing, I reached over and grabbed my headsets, and this song by Lionel Richie comes on.
So see how this song actually saved his life. But first, it's a best-selling book that became a major motion picture.
The story starts with a failure, with a meltdown.
Spend 7 days in Utopia, you'll find your game.
Author David Cook talks about 7 days in Utopia up next.
Do you have money to burn? If not, you need to know that the paper dollars you're invested your life savings in are being consumed right now in a growing blaze of inflation and declining value. Economists know why the dollar is burning and at risk of crashing. It's because politicians and central bankers keep printing them. And this makes the dollars you've worked so hard for worth less and less. The politicians and bankers hated the gold standard because it forced them to be honest. That's why the US dollar keeps losing value and could soon crash. The good news is that you can create your own personal gold standard and keep your savings protected when the dollar crashes. Call or visit online now. Find out more about the best performing assets of the 21st century from the best company in the country, Swiss America.
My name is Roger Stump, and I'm a cancer survivor. The surgeon said it's inoperable. It's already in your liver. My wife, Brenda, sat there and cried. And I'm thinking, I can't die right now. I'm only 52 years old. I was so distraught. I've heard Cancer Treatment Centers of America had experience with pancreatic cancers. It was like night and day. The hospital just breeds an environment of hope. You'd get a CT scan, and the next morning, the results were read to you. We'd go up there, I just knew it was going to be a good result. You could just see the joy on Dr. Granick's face.
Call now, and we'll show you how the most compassionate people anywhere put you at the center of everything we do. Together, we'll explore real treatment options you may not even know exist.
Cancer Treatment Centers of America is such a different place because they give you hope. I would strongly urge you to call them and get a second opinion.
Please call today.
Okay, so yesterday we started to show you a feature on the new movie 7 Days in Utopia, but we had a little bit of technical difficulty. So here we go again. The film stars Robert Duvall and Lucas Black, and it's the story of a young golfer. But as our very own Tim Branson shows us, the movie is so much more than about golf. Take a look.
Utopia is a peaceful, out-of-the-way town in the West Texas Hill Country. If you've never heard of Utopia, you're not alone.
373 people.
375. Megan Monroe had twins last week.
The town is the setting for the new film 7 Days in Utopia. It's based on the best-selling novel Golf's Sacred Journey by noted performance coach Dr. David Cook. It stems from his 25-plus years experience as a sports psychologist.
The story starts with a failure, with a meltdown, and this young man who is a aspiring mini-tour professional golfer in San Antonio, Texas, has the meltdown of the century. And he just has to leave the scene of the accident. So he begins to just drive out of the town, frustrated, upset, knowing that he's going to be the butt end of a bunch of jokes for the rest of his life.
That's when the golfer, played by Lucas Black, finds his way to Utopia.
You hurt, son?
I'll get over.
He meets a rancher named Johnny, played by Robert Duvall. It turns out the old cowboy knows a thing or two about golf and offers the young man a challenge.
Spend 7 days in Utopia, you'll find your game.
So for the next week, Johnny uses some unconventional methods to teach him the essence of the game.
Johnny understands the kid doesn't have a performance problem. He's got a heart problem. And Johnny uses all sorts of things around this little community of Utopia to draw some the truths of the game out for him.
It's then that Johnny reveals the core of his teaching.
You have to see it, feel it, trust it.
There's three elements in performance. Number one, you have to see what you want to have happen. Number two is to feel or have a strategy that goes with that. And third is to trust yourself as you perform that. So it's a very simple see it, feel it, trust it strategy that gets the mind off of all the negative things, all the things that could go wrong, and focuses them on what is it that you're trying to accomplish.
David gave me a demonstration on how see, feel, trust works.
See that shot. We're going to feel that shot. We're going to trust it instead of seeing the problem. So let's do that. I'm going to take a look. I'm going to see this ball going right under the tree there. And it's gonna roll out about, 80, 90 yards there, just in front of the flag. So I see it, I walk up there, and now I understand, feel, I just wanna feel. I'm not gonna get tight or anxious because of the tree, and I'm just gonna see this ball go under the tree, see it, feel it, and then I'm just gonna trust it. Nice shot, thank you.
Then it was my turn.
And that's not what I saw, Dave. That's not the shot I saw.
Just because you go through the see it, feel it, trust it doesn't mean it's always going to happen just right.
I wasn't ready to give up just yet.
There we go.
Perfect shot. Look at that. Get up there by the hole.
Hey, it works.
Woo! All right. This book is not about golf. It's about performance in life and what that means to God and how God can be honored through our performance.
At the end of the 7-day journey, Johnny brings the golfer to the Waresville Cemetery. It's here where he teaches him the most important lesson of all.
First, he had to learn to get rid of the baggage he was carrying.
Because I'm not your father.
You don't know anything about my dad.
The golfer's bringing baggage. He's bringing a bunch of lies with him. Lies that say that your self-worth is based on the score that you shoot, which is like many men in our culture, that our worth, our value, our identity is based on how we perform in life. That's the wrong scoreboard. God has a totally different scoreboard. You are my child. The score at the end of the game is Jesus wins, and you are a player in the game.
With a renewed passion and sense of purpose, the golfer enters the next PGA tournament, and, well, you'll just have to see for yourself. In the meantime, you should know that see, feel, trust is much more than just a strategy for good performance.
And the sea field trust in the end ends up being see his face, feel his presence, and trust his love. And if we could walk every moment of our life seeing the face of Christ, feeling the presence of Jesus, and trusting his love moment by moment, knowing that the God of the universe that's called us into being is with us and walking with us, oh my gracious.
I love that. See it, feel it, trust it. That is fantastic. We're going to take that on today, right, Pat?
That'll help my golf game, anything.
Exactly. Well, 7 Days in Utopia, it actually opens up in theaters nationwide this coming Friday, September 2nd. So if you'd like to read the book that actually the movie is based on, it's called Golf Sacred Journey by David Cook. And guess what? It's available wherever books are sold. Well, all right, I'm going to hop it over to you.
Bob Duvall is a wonderful guy, and every movie he's in is good. If he's playing it, he's so natural.
Yeah.
He's just so down-to-earth natural. His daddy was like an admiral in the Navy, and he was born, lived in Virginia. He's just a really nice guy.
You're talking Robert Duvall.
Well, I said Bob.
I know. It threw me, though.
Well.
It took me a moment, but
Bob,
I found you.
Bob and Robert are the same thing, in case you... Bob is a shortage of Robert.
Pat, you have been picking on me all day. People don't know he's been picking on me all day. I say nothing. Okay.
When David Lewis was sentenced to 24 years in Leavenworth, he figured he would use the time to get an education from the criminal masterminds who were incarcerated with him. But after 6 years in prison, David couldn't hack it anymore, so he planned a permanent escape from Leavenworth.
David Lewis was a good child, but something about the streets enticed him.
These guys are riding fancy cars. They have all the women. You know, they have all the money. I wanted to be able to have that respect that they had, you know, and have that influence.
David eventually realized nothing good would come of this lifestyle, so he decided to enlist in the Army. He was smart and had the potential to rise through the ranks to leadership. Instead, he chose to distinguish himself another way, as a criminal.
People would, just to get a few extra bucks, they would go purchase the alcohol and the cigarettes at the military store, and then they would actually go sell them for a huge markup. I didn't think myself above the law, because the rationale, the justification is everybody's doing, and nobody gets prosecuted for this.
David's small crimes led to bigger heists.
If we walked into an area and we saw where there was going to be a huge amount of cash, you know, we would plan to literally go get that cash.
So what's the game plan again?
We knew that when soldiers were in the field, back in those days before the automatic draft, you got an officer who's got two briefcases, they're full of money, and they've got to go out to this remote area, give them their money, out in the woods. We would simply be out there waiting for them, and we would rob them.
Eventually, David was caught and sentenced to 24 years in Fort Leavenworth military prison.
I got this criminal thing wrong. I want to get it right. I'm in this institution. I've got the best and the worst of the worst around me. You know, and I've got famous people here, you know, the people that you've heard of on the news. I'm just gonna just get as much information and much knowledge as I can to become this master criminal when I get out.
But the horrible reality of life in prison overwhelmed David. And after 5 years in Leavenworth, he decided to kill himself.
I've got to deal with the craziness. I've got to deal with the yelling. I've got to deal with the bars closing. I've got to deal with all these issues again, you know. And I had to admit to myself that at that point, I was really tired of it. I actually take my sheet off the bed, tie it up, and make it into a makeshift noose and prepare for my last night on Earth. While I was preparing, I reached over and grabbed my headsets, and this song by Lionel Richie, called Jesus is Love, it comes on. And all my life I've heard that, you know, Jesus, you know, he loves you. He won't let you down. And this particular night, it reached somewhere deep in my core.
David began to pray.
I'm just there crying, bawling like a baby, admitting some ugly truths about myself, talking to God for the very first time, really talking to God. I'm at the lowest point in my life. But if you get me through this, I am going to, as best as I can, have an impact on everybody that I come in contact with. When that cell door opened the next morning, for the very first time, I was free. And I was free inside of prison.
As David grew in his newfound faith, he began to encourage other inmates.
We started a little believers group, you know, and we would minister to folks while we were there.
After David served an 8-year sentence, he was released. Today, he visits prisons to share his testimony with the inmates.
David has made a great impact here at Richmond City Jail. We love him, we care about him because we know that he actually cares. He knows the role of being in here, and it gives the residents here at Richmond City Jail hope that they can follow in his footsteps.
When David came, he inspired me. You had to change your mind thinking and let God cut you as a diamond. So when I surrendered, I found myself being a blessing to the guys at the jail.
Being in prison is not just a physical thing, you know, because it's about being trapped in your circumstances. The devil had me in his crosshairs, and he was trying to take me out. You know, and it would have been just another life unfulfilled. God, he means everything to me. He was patient enough to love me when I didn't love myself. He was patient enough to accept me when I finally came to my senses. The example that I'm trying to set inspires somebody to say, you know what? I may be trapped by something, but if God can do this for him, then surely he can do it for me.
If the Son shall set you free, you will be free indeed. You know, they said Lincoln freed the slaves, the Emancipation Proclamation, but he didn't free people who were bound up by spiritual problems. And many of you are slaves. Some are slaves to bad habits, some are slaves to anger, some are slaves to lust. Some are slaves to fear. There's so many things that have bound you. What has got you bound up? Have you thought about it sometime? Am I a slave to alcohol? Am I a slave to painkillers? What are you a slave to? God has set you free. If the Son will make you free, you can walk out of that prison and you can be free. You don't have to be behind bars to be in prison. And the fact that you're not behind bars doesn't mean that you are not in prison. God will set you free. And right now, today, I want you to declare for freedom. On the Liberty Bill, it says, proclaim freedom, proclaim liberty throughout the land. That was the year of Jubilee. Proclaim liberty. Let's proclaim liberty for you today. Bow your head wherever you are. Say these words. Lord, I proclaim liberty. I speak freedom. I declare before God that I will be free because Jesus Christ has set me free. Lord, come into my life. Fill me with your Spirit and break the bonds that have held me. In Jesus' name, I receive you and I thank you. Amen. Now, if you prayed with me, I want to help you get started. This is just the first step, and there's much, much, much more. I went into the audio room some time ago, and I sat down in front of a microphone, and I did a teaching, 73 minutes. I went through all the various things that happened to you. In the exchange life, you have a new life in Christ. You're a new person, a new creation. Well, what happens if you sin? What about the baptism of the Spirit? What about the second coming? All these things, I've discussed it all. And I'm going to give this to you as my special gift if you prayed with me just then. So pick up the phone and call in. Say, I prayed with Pat. I have given my heart to the Lord. And I want a new day. It's 1-800-759-0700. Call now. Christy!
Pat, well, still ahead, you're going to meet the woman who set the world record for the fastest Appalachian Trail hike. She's amazing. And her name is Jennifer Davis, and she's joining us live on today's 700 Club.
Hi, I'm Christy Watts. Okay, so I have a question for you. How's life? Listen, I know we all face challenges and we all go through difficult times, don't we? I mean, I know I do. But did you know that the staff right here at CBN sets aside a special week of prayer each autumn just to pray for you? Because we care about you. We care about what's going on in your life. Listen, there are absolutely no prayer requests that are too big or even too small. We just want to pray for you. So please, mail in your prayer request today.
When you look in the mirror and you imagine erasing years of aging,
that's what I used to look like.
Lifestyle Lift takes only about an hour. See the difference immediately.
I'm Linda. I'm 70 years old. Can you believe it?
Call now for a free information kit. It's quick, affordable, and takes only about an hour. Lifestyle Lift, a breakthrough medical procedure that helps remove wrinkles, frown lines, and sagging skin. Call now for a free information kit. Consultations are free. Call Lifestyle Lift today.
Welcome back to the 700 Club. Israel has sent two more warships to the Red Sea to guard against another terror attack. Terrorists from Egypt's Sinai Peninsula attacked a southern Israeli highway nearly 2 weeks ago. 8 people died in that raid and a number of others were wounded. Now Israel's military warns that the Gaza-based Islamic Jihad may try another strike from Egypt as Muslims mark the end of Ramadan. Defense Minister Ehud Barak says Hamas in Gaza will be held responsible for any attack. Egypt's government has had trouble patrolling the Sinai after the fall of President Hosni Mubarak back in February. Wildfires are sweeping throughout parts of Texas and Oklahoma, and the devastating drought in those areas is only fueling the fire. Strong winds are keeping firefighters from making much progress. At least 25 homes in one Texas community have been destroyed. That fire stretches 7,500 acres. In Oklahoma, the fires are mainly in rural areas, but already a dozen homes have been destroyed. Several areas are under mandatory evacuation orders. No major injuries have been reported from either fire. You can always get the latest from CBN News by going to our website at cbnnews.com. Pat and Christy will be back with more of the 700 Club after this.
I saw you on TV. I gotta say, it was painful to watch.
Try living it.
Spend 7 days in Utopia.
Wow.
You'll find your game.
First, you have to see it, feel it, trust it.
Reminds me of someone else I used to know.
That he does.
I think some time here might do you good.
Sure is beautiful.
I don't think that you're coming here was an accident.
7 days in Utopia, rated G.
To see this week's top on-demand videos, go to cbn.com.
Okay, so could you imagine having to deal with this? Freezing temperatures, attacks by insects, encounters with snakes, and lightning strike, and even a stalker. I know it sounds like a movie, but it's not. These are just some of the obstacles Jennifer Davis actually had to overcome to set the world record for the fastest hike of the Appalachian Trail. She did it. Check it out. If you're wondering how long it is, 2,180 miles. Take a look.
Instead of getting a job after college, Jennifer Farr Davis set out alone to hike the Appalachian Trail. It took Jennifer 4 months to trek from Georgia to Maine the first time. But in July 2011, her record-breaking journey took only 46 days. In her book, Becoming Odessa, Jennifer shares how she stepped into the woods as a naive college student and ended her journey as a person she'd never imagined.
So please welcome to the 700 Club, Jennifer Farr Davis. Jennifer, it's so good to see you.
Thanks for having me.
Okay, so the first thing that I think of is crazy.
Yes.
So what was it that said, you know what, I think I'm going to, you know, hike this trail, the one of the longest trails in the United States?
Well, we're on the 700 Club, so I can easily say it was God. I mean, I think it was certainly a calling looking back, and I felt like it was something I wanted to do. I knew I loved being in nature, and I knew I loved using my body, and this seemed like a great adventure to have after college. So that's what it was at first, an adventure. I didn't think it would become a lifestyle. But 8 years later, I love the trail more than ever, and I can't wait to get back out there.
That's just amazing. You know, when I did, when I kind of talked about the setup piece, I said, you know, that there's snakes and insects and even, you know, getting struck by lightning. These are things that you really experienced. Tell us about some of those great adventures.
Yeah.
And you seriously got struck by lightning?
I seriously got struck by lightning. So maybe that explains part of it. I don't know. But yeah, everyone always goes, snakes and insects and bears. Oh my.
Yeah.
But I think part of the hesitation or anxiety or fear about those animals or instances is that we don't usually experience them on a day-to-day basis. And so I went out into the woods thinking, these are going to be major obstacles. But then after seeing so many snakes, so many bears, I learned that's just part of nature. And they don't want anything to do with me. They just want to be left alone. And so being out there and being able to experience that and view nature in its natural habitat is one of my favorite parts of being outdoors.
Now, you talked about the Lord, and really it was kind of the Lord who inspired you, but more than that, it had to have been Jesus Christ himself and probably the 12 disciples along with him that walked you along that trail. So what kind of life lessons did you learn just about yourself and about the Lord during this time?
Well, it's really neat because we're all on journeys, and the trail is a very literal journey, and it's physical, but it's also very spiritual. And for me, when I started, I hiked by myself, and that was a very transformative experience for me because in society, we always have other places or other people to look to. And on the trail, I didn't have that support network, so I always had to go straight to God, and so I would. In a lightning storm, if it was gorgeous outside, that's who I would share it with. I'd say, I'm terrified, I'm excited, this is amazing. And so it's just this walking prayer, which is really a beautiful thing, and it makes you very appreciative for the people in your life. And speaking of people, about 3.5 years ago, I got married. And since that time, I've been able to share the trails with my husband, which has just enriched the experience for me.
That is beautiful. When I was reading some of your information, I kept thinking of the word endurance and perseverance.
Yeah.
I mean, when you set out to accomplish such a lofty goal, it's not like in the middle of it, you could say, okay, I'm done.
Yeah.
I'm sure you wanted to. So what was it that kept you pressing forward and moving on to say, no, I'm going to accomplish this?
Well, I think when we talk about endurance and perseverance, even biblically, we also need to talk about hope. And on the trail, hope is such a concept for me that I grasp onto because it's not always easy. It's very difficult. And there's times when I'm hurting and I'm upset and I don't think I can carry on. But the trail has proven to me that it does get better and we do belong in a natural environment and we can overcome things. And so I believe the trail has taught me above all else to hold on to hope and just keep going forward.
You know, sometimes I think about in our own personal walk how we get distracted as Christians.
Yeah.
You know, we've got technology and television and we've got this and we have that, even electricity.
Yes.
You didn't have all of those vices, so to speak.
Right.
So did you find that you could see God clear, hear his voice even that much louder, or sense his presence even greater?
I really feel like creation is one of the ways God most clearly expresses his love for humanity. And now more than ever, with all the distractions of computer and cell phones and TVs, being able to go out into nature and just live simply and quietly and positively interact with other people without distractions, we need that so much. And the next generation coming up, they're not experiencing it. And so one of the things I'm most passionate about is just giving them that option. And I don't expect them to necessarily take a through hike, but to learn that they can spend an afternoon outdoors without their cell phone and enjoy it and get to know themselves and be okay with themselves is a message that we really need right now.
I love that. And who God created them to be.
Exactly.
It's beautiful. Okay, now you broke a world record.
Yay.
Girl, let's talk about that. Even though I should have said it at the beginning,
yeah,
let's talk about it now.
Well, I'm glad you didn't say it at the beginning because it has been a progression. I mean, it took me 7 years, 11,000 miles to get to the point where I'm at right now.
Wow.
And the record was actually my third trip on the Appalachian Trail. So I had completed it twice before this summer. And the record for me is just an expression of my love for the trail. You cannot hike 46.9 miles a day for 46 days unless you love something.
Yeah.
I was waking up before the sunrise, going to bed after the sunset, hiking all day, every day, because I feel like, for me personally, that's what I was created to do. And I had my husband's support the entire time, which for us, that bond was so intense and so intimate and such an amazing thing to share, that the takeaway for me this summer was that we can do all things through Christ, and that we need to be able to value and build on the relationships that He's given us.
I love that. That's a beautiful message. And listen, if you want to just learn more about great adventures.
Because
this is a great adventure with the Lord and with the lions and the tigers and the bears.
Yes.
Oh, my. Listen, Jen's book is called Becoming Odessa, and it's available wherever books are sold.
Thank you so much.
I really appreciate you. Congratulations.
Thanks.
Absolutely. Well, up next, a single mom gets seriously sick.
When you're the sole source of income for your family, you know, the first thing is, what's going to happen? What are we going to do? How am I going to take care of her? I wondered if I'd see her graduate, get married, have kids. A lot of days like that.
But see who helped this woman and her daughter actually make it. That's all next on the 700 Club.
Trouble sleeping?
Do you wear a mask for your CPAP machine?
Stop using that old leaky mask. Get a new one now.
CPAP Care Club now offers replacement masks, filters, and tubing every 90 days for those on Medicare and most private insurance.
Imagine a soft, brand new nasal mask delivered right to your door just as you need it.
These new sleep masks fit great, don't leak, and are ultra comfortable.
But that's not all. CPAP Care Club will send you one of these.
My brand new face mask and my sleep apnea supplies show up right at the front door.
Wake up your partner less often with a soft, brand new mask.
With CPAP Care Club, you get all your supplies delivered to your door. We pay shipping, we work with Medicare or your insurance, and we handle the paperwork. The 30-day comfort guarantee lets you see if a new mask is right for you. Change the way you care for your sleep apnea. Call CPAP Care Club now. Shipping is free, and so is the call.
It's our 50th celebration, and you're invited.
It's live.
Free concerts all day long. Plus family fun, studio tours, and fireworks. Go to cbn.com/50 for details.
As a single mother, Angela Lathers was already struggling. Then when her health took a turn for the worst, Angela was worried about how she could take care of her child. Here's how she found help for herself and her daughter.
Angela Lathers has a steady job working as a legal secretary in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. But finances have always been tight because she's been a single mom for the last 20 years.
And sometimes, you know, you may not know where your next meal is going to come from.
Things got even harder 5 years ago when Angela's kidneys failed. She went on dialysis and at times couldn't work. Her daughter was one of her main concerns.
And when you're the sole source of income for your family, you know, the first thing is like, what's going to happen? What are we going to do? How am I going to take care of her? There were many days I looked at her and I wondered if I'd see her graduate, get married, have kids. A lot of days like that.
Then she started going to a single moms group at Healing Place Church. The women receive food, diapers, and other necessities provided by Operation Blessing. Jennifer Maggio leads the ministry.
Sometimes maybe they come for the giveaways, but we're going to give them a little bit of Jesus when they're there too. So we don't care why they come. When they get there, we're going to give them truth.
Angela got a kidney transplant and saw her daughter Brianna graduate from high school. Now grants and scholarships are paying for Brianna to go to college.
It's a much brighter future for her.
Angela says it's still hard juggling the cost of medication, school books, and groceries. But with help from Operation Blessing and the Dream Center, she's making a better life for her family.
It is truly a blessing, because if you don't have to say, well, I got to take this $100 and go to the grocery store, I can actually know that I didn't have to choose between being hungry and getting that medication or buying that book. It's a wonderful feeling. It truly is.
Thank God we can help people like Angela. You know, we reach out all around it, and we do it in your name. We do it in your name. So if you want to participate, you can just send something to Operation Blessing at Well, it's CBN.com. Or you can dial 1-800-759-0700. Somebody's there who loves you. Mm-hmm. Now, let's get some questions.
Absolutely. You know, our chat room's been open, so Samantha was the first one who said, my grown children don't call, talk, or even give me the time of day. I can understand if they're busy, but it's as if I don't even matter anymore. I called my daughter, but she told me she needed her space. What do I do?
I think you'll give them to the hands of the Lord, but, I mean, that makes you sick. You remember that song, Cats in the Cradle?
Cats in the Cradle and the Silver Spoon.
That's right.
Little boy blue and a man in the moon.
Do it again later. I got a little, got more time. Well, I think you reap what you sow, and there must be something along the early days of those children that wasn't sowed properly.
That's what I was thinking.
Yeah, you really, I mean, if you grow up loving them and they're close to you, then they're not going to be estranged. But somehow, when they say they need their space, there's something wrong when they were younger. But it's too late to do anything about it now. All you can do is love them. All you can do is love them. Let them know you love them. Be there for them. Because one day they're going to turn and they say, you know, I need mom. I need my background.
Yeah, I was praying the other day, and the Lord was showing me one of the greatest lines we could ever say to someone is, one, I love you, and two, I'm sorry. So maybe there's an I'm sorry that needs to happen in that family.
It may be.
Yeah. Well, Tracy says, I homeschooled my son last year, and I wanted to homeschool him again this year, but my ex-husband is trying to fight that. I'm worried that he's going to take me to court over this. Does he have any legal standing?
It depends on who has custody. If you have legal custody, then you could make decisions concerning the education of your child. Assuming that your homeschooling is in accordance with the norms for education in your state, but it depends on your custody. If you have custody, but that's the kind of thing you might talk to a lawyer about. But the last thing you want to do is get in a fight over this if you can help it. All right.
Exactly. All right. Jennifer says, I was raised in Episcopal, but recently the church I've attended for more than 40 years called a gay priest to our rector. I have mixed feelings about this. Is this reason enough for me to leave my church?
That is total reason. If they have gone so far away from the norm of God, there are many people right now who are leaving the old Episcopal church and joining the Anglican church. And the Anglican congregations are springing up with people who are just disgusted with what's happening in the Episcopal Church. It breaks your heart. But where did the Episcopal Church come from? Henry VIII wanted to divorce his wife, and the Pope didn't like it, so he set up his own church. That's where it came from.
I didn't know that. Look at you, plethora of knowledge.
Plethora. All right. That's where it came from. But I tell you, the articles in the Church of England, most evangelical things, they're just beautiful. Some of the great saints that have been back in the Episcopal Church. But switch to Anglican, you'll be fine. What's next?
All right. Last question. John says, what do you think about scientists trying to find the God particle? What is a God particle? And P.S., what kind of tricks can Blue do? We'll talk about Blue later.
Blue can jump. He can roll over. Like crazy. All right. I don't know whether they're looking for the first thing that started. You know, they think the Big Bang came together, but there had to be some matter that formed to get some sort of a mass, and then it exploded, and out of that you came to the universe. So was there some super dense particle? I guess that's what they're talking about, but hey, don't look for a God particle. Look for the God Almighty.
Come on, brother.
That was
good.
Created the heaven and the earth. Tomorrow, a woman looking for love in a chat room converts to Islam and lives to regret it. And today, we leave you with these words, walk in the light as He is in the light. We'll see you tomorrow. Bye-bye.
Here at CBN, we see amazing things happen when we stand together.
That's why we want to say thank you to the thousands of you who recently pledged to join the 700 Club.
Your monthly gift makes it possible to bring crucial help to those who need it most.
You help heal the sick, feed the hungry, and preach the gospel across America and throughout the world.
You've brought health and hope to people in desperate need.
And changed their lives forever.
Chen Chu couldn't hear or speak. His parents were too poor to afford the speech therapy he needed. His mother prayed that God would help her little boy. That's when you were the answer to her prayers and provided Chen Chu with the therapy he needed. You took him out of a silent prison and gave him hope for the future.
So please, watch for this mailing and send in your pledge. This year, millions will know
the love and saving power of Jesus Christ.
And that only happens because you were there.